disgusting, especially this part. Music is, in general, disgusting. What is music? What does it do to us and why? They say that music stirs the soul. Stupidity, a lie. Music makes me forget my true condition. Under the influence of music, I seem to feel what I do not feel. I think I understand what I do not understand. I believe I know what I do not know. Music transports me immediately into the composer's state of mind. Our souls become united, and I pass from one state to another. Why? I don't know. Beethoven, for instance, who wrote the Kreutzer Sonata, probably knew why he found himself in a certain state of mind. That state led him to commit certain actions, which had therefore a meaning. But for me, there is no meaning. It only provokes me, which doesn't lead to anything. And that is why music is so dangerous. Should it really be allowed to play this presto in polite societies among ladies wearing low-cut dresses? Should it be allowed to play this presto, applaud politely, have a glass of wine, and gossip about the latest scandals? Our emotions are wrenched, becoming unable to respond to time or space or to be transformed. I maintain no. I am a wreck. A cripple. Nevertheless, something is living within me. I know that. Humans can easily deduce what the composition of the metals of the sun and the stars are, but the revelations of our filthy, disgusting lives, that is a cruel discovery.
Thank you.
we move to Moscow. When cohabitation between two parents becomes unbearable, you feel an urge to live in the city. Moving seems like a necessity. Naturally, we use the excuse of our children's welfare to justify the sudden move. In the city, you are in constant activity, no time to descend into the depth of your own mind. Boutiques, social relationships, meetings, the children's welfare, education. There are visits to be made and received. One travels back to the country manor to deal with different matters and then return to the city. You are busily immersed in furnishing the new apartment. It worked as a diversion for us, and the torment of our life together diminished. In that manner, we made one winter pass by, and the subsequent winter, it happened. Nobody noticed it. Children. My wife was suffering from ill health, and the doctor forbade her to conceive any more children. The last justification for our cohabitation vanished. Children. And life became unbearable. Her sister takes care of the children. They don't trust me with them. I am considered too highly strung. I see them, but give them to me. Perhaps I could erase them in a way that they wouldn't turn out to be like their parents. I don't know. I cannot do anything for them. My wife conceived 5 children in 8 years. After these years, she changed. She developed physically and became as stunning as a late summer bloom. She had been brought up in the belief that there is only one thing of real value, true love. But love for a husband like me, polluted by jealousy and ill nature, could not possibly be the one true love. She seemed to be constantly on the lookout, as if waiting for something. She opened her eyes and saw that she was neglecting God's fair creation and its thousands of joys, joys she did not yet understand. It seemed as if she was thinking or feeling, it is all about enjoying the present. Time flies by and will not come back. Then there was this man, Tukhachevsky, the violinist. Thank you. It started before my 16th birthday. I was still in school. I had not yet had relations with women, but already I suffered under their influence. Not one woman in particular, but women as something warm, mysterious. The woman. Each woman. The concept of the naked woman. Then one of my brother's friends came along, a so-called man of the world, who taught us to drink and gamble. One night of intoxication, he convinced us to go there. We went there, and I, a 15-year-old boy, defiled myself and gave myself to a woman without understanding what I did. From then on, I just went further and further down the path of promiscuity. I see myself and these 30-year-old men when we washed, clean-shaven and in coat and uniform, invaded parlours and ballrooms, an enchanting symbol of purity. I never for a minute abandoned my intentions to marry and build a noble and pure life, and with that aim in view, I scrutinised the country's most beautiful young daughters. Finally, I found one that I considered on the level with myself. One night, after a boat trip, we came back to the house after twilight in moonlight, and while I was sitting beside her, captivated by her vulnerability, her charming, slender body, and her beautiful curly hair, it became suddenly clear to me. This was she. I returned home enthusiastic. I had made up my mind. She was utterly complete and, therefore, worthy to be my wife. I proposed the next day. Nothing was missing in our relationship. The love, the atmosphere, the poetry. I was madly in love. Not only did she appear to me to be a perfect being at this time, but I appeared to myself to be a complete person. My pride and self-contentment knew no bounds. And yet, what kind of love is that? This love that alone consecrates marriage. The true love. What does this true love mean? I don't know. To prefer one man or one woman to the exclusion of all others? For how long? For a lifetime? But that happens only in novels. Every man feels what you call true love towards each pretty woman he sees. I invited him in. I introduced him to my wife, Trukhachevsky, the violinist. From the very beginning, he made an unpleasant impression on me. But strangely, some occult fatal power not only prevented me from sending him away, but on the contrary, induced me to suffer his company. He had moist eyes, almond-shaped, smiling red lips, hair brushed to the latest fashion, button boots, fair tie, Paris, a vermin in my eyes. Not because he came into our lives. Had it not been him, it would have been someone else. As if on purpose, I steered the conversation towards his skill as a violinist. I introduced him to my wife. They immediately began to converse together. He pretended to be solely interested in conversing about music. But he looked at my wife, as all debauchees look at beautiful women. From the first moment onward, she was pleased with him. And she felt joy in getting both piano, as my uncle played, and violin music into the house. She was disturbingly pretty, her eyes glittering with joy. But when she glanced at me, she understood my feelings and concealed her emotions. I smiled agreeably, pretending that all this pleased me extremely. We talked of music, of Paris, and all sorts of trivialities. Trukhachevsky rose to go, but stood standing with his hat in his hand. I remember that moment perfectly. It was in my power not to invite him back. but I cast a glance first at him, then at her. Don't flatter yourself thinking I am jealous or that I'm afraid of you, I thought. And invited him back for the following night. He arrived the next evening, as agreed. When my uncle and he had finished playing and we were sitting at the dinner table, I filled his glass and grew enthusiastic about his playing. The question remaining was if I, her husband, should stand in their way. It was so obvious. I suffered in painful agony, and in spite of, or perhaps even because of that, an unknown force impelled me against my will, not only to be polite, but even amiable towards him. I remember the strange feeling with which I observed his neck, his white neck, and his skipping gait, like that of a bird, when he left the room. This man not only pleased her. Toward me, she no longer had any feelings apart from those of perpetual irritation and ill temper, occasionally interrupted by the customary sensuality. Thanks to the impression that music produces on susceptible people, he could easily conquer her, subjugate her, and do with her as he pleased. I get home from an exhibition, walk into the parlor. Suddenly my heart sinks as if a heavy stone is weighing it down. Why? Not until I reach my study do I realize what it is. I return to the hall to verify my intuition. I'm not mistaken. It is his overcoat, the fashionable kind. He has come. I pass through the nursery, into the parlour. My youngest child, Lisa, is sitting hidden behind a book, the old nurse beside her. The door into the piano room is closed. I hear a slow arpeggio and their voices. I listen, not understanding. The overriding feeling, as in every bad feeling, was self-pity. In front of the child, I thought. I must have looked terrifying since Lisa looked at me with fright in her eyes. What should I do? Should I go in? I can't, but I can't go back. The old nurse raised her eyes to mine as if she understood. I opened the door. She was standing in the angle of the grand piano. He was sitting at the keyboard and making arpeggios with his long fingers. If she was stunned and just pretended not to be, I don't know. In any case, she looked not in the least shocked. She did not move. How glad I am that you've come. Are you familiar with the Kreutzer Sonata for piano and violin? She said in a tone she never would have used had we been alone. I saluted Tchaikovsky silently. He shook hands with me directly with a smile that seemed to me full of mockery, and explained that he had wanted to talk to my uncle and that he had brought some music, including the Kreutzer Sonata by Beethoven. It was also natural, so simple. But at the same time, I was certain that they were conspiring to deceive me. I remained just as long as was necessary in order to dispel the unpleasantness of my abrupt entrance. He then went into the hall and asked me to give my uncle his regards. I accompanied him with a special courtesy. Why shouldn't you accompany a man who has come to disturb your peace and ruin the happiness of the entire family? When I confronted her, she pretended not to understand me. Or perhaps she really didn't. She remained standing in the middle of the room, offended. "You've become so terribly uncouth," she began, and suddenly referred to an incident when I had apparently been terribly rude to her sister. "Since then, nothing you do astonishes me." "Yes, first offend, humiliate, abuse, and then afterwards hold me responsible." Suddenly, I felt an incredible rage towards her, and for the first time, I decided to express this rage physically. Simultaneously, I understood my state of mind. Would it be well for me to surrender myself to my fury? I immediately answered myself, yes, it would be well. It would frighten her. And instead of dousing the fire, I fueled it, accelerated in feeling my anger grow more and more fiercely. I felt a terrible desire to beat her, to kill her, but I knew, of course, that that could not happen. To give vent to my anger, I seized a paperweight from the table and threw it at the floor by her feet. "Get out!" My aim was good. I nearly hit her. She turned to leave, but paused in the doorway. I grabbed anything I could find on the desk, a candlestick, inkwell, and hurled it to the floor. "Get out!" She fled, and I instantly calmed down. I can't look back at our honeymoon without feeling ashamed. In good faith, I had wanted to be good, but it was all in vain. I suffered continuously from anxiety, shame, and reluctance. It started early. I believe it was on the third or fourth day that I found my wife sad. I started to embrace her, which surely, in my opinion, was all that she could desire. She pushed me away and began to weep. Why? It was impossible to understand. I accused her of being capricious, and her whole face changed from sadness to fury. She began to reproach me in harsh and wounding terms for my selfishness and cruelty. I looked at her. Her whole face expressed hostility towards me and, yes, hatred. What? Love is the unity of souls, and here she hates me? Impossible. It cannot be. I had tried to calm her, only to be confronted by such an immovable and cold hostility that even one small moment was enough to seize me with keen irritation. And we exchanged many disagreeable remarks. The impression of this first quarrel was terrible. I say quarrel, but the term is inaccurate. It was the sudden discovery of the abyss that actually existed between us. To this day, I'm still astonished that I could lose myself so completely. I found no reason for our hatred. And each time, it ended in reconciliation. Words, declarations, tears, glances, a smile, embraces. Disgusting.
Thank you.
The old servant came to me and said that my wife was in a fit of hysterics. I went to her. She sobbed and laughed, incapable of expressing anything. Her whole body was in a tremble. She was not shamming, she was really sick. Towards daylight, she grew calmer. We became reconciled. We kissed, caressed each other. The next morning, I confessed to her that I was jealous of Trukhachevsky. She was not in the least embarrassed and began to laugh in the most natural way. So strangely did the possibility of falling in love with such a man seem to her. Can an honest woman entertain any feelings for such a man beyond the pleasure of enjoying music with him? But if you wish, I am prepared to never see him again. It would be horrible if anyone would think that he means something to me. I can't even think about it. And she wasn't lying. She believed what she said. All of it. I felt so light-hearted. Felt that everything was perfect. 2 days later, I bade my wife farewell and left for the country manor in a tranquil state of mind. In the country, there was always much to be done. I spent 2 whole days in meetings. The third day, a letter arrived from my wife. I read it immediately. She wrote to the children of my uncle, of the servants, of her purchases, and, as if were perfectly natural, that Trukhachevsky had been at the house, had brought her music, and asked for my uncle, who had left for the country. Trukhachevsky had soon departed, as my wife had declined to invite him in. Disregarding the fact that Trukhachevsky had returned during my absence, there was something guarded about the letter. Once more my heart swelled, and the mad beast of jealousy began to roar. But I was afraid of that beast, and I imposed silence upon it. What could be more natural than what she had written? I went to bed thinking only of business that remained to be done. As sometimes happens, I awoke with a sudden jolt. I immediately thought of her, of my insane love for her. I thought of Trukhachevsky, and that between them, everything had happened. I strived to be sensible. How stupid! There is no reason, none at all. And why humiliate her and myself by supposing such horrors? But on the other hand, why should it not have happened? He was not married. I could see his athletic body, the way his teeth ground the gristle of the cutlass. And there was always the mutual interest in music which united them. And now I remember their intimate glances on Sunday evening after the Kreutzer Sonata. Was it not clear that everything between them was done that evening? And was it not clear that between them there was no more obstacles? I saw how they avoided each other's eyes, and only when he poured some water for her did they look at each other and smile imperceptibly. Yes, everything has happened. Talk is impossible. I felt afraid, and I did not sleep all night. At 5 o'clock, I decided that I could stand the strain no longer and that I would leave directly. At 8 o'clock, I got into the carriage and started off. The morning was beautiful. The coolness of the autumn was accompanied by a brilliant sun. The road was level and the air invigorating. Day broke as I was sitting there and I felt at ease. I looked at the horses, the fields, and the people we passed. I forgot where I was headed. Sometimes it seemed to me that I was just travelling, and none of the things that had upset me existed. But this tranquil state ended with the carriage drive. The following 8 hours by rail was so terrible that I shall never in my whole life forget them. The sound of the rails triggered my imagination, and I could no longer control it. I saw before my eyes what was happening at home, how I was deceived. I burned with rage and with a peculiar feeling of humiliation. I could no longer block out these imaginary pictures. They were there, and I believed in their reality. I was like a beast in a cage. I got up and went over to the window. I began to pace back and forth as if to make the train go faster. I tried to think of something else. The worst suffering was in the uncertainty, the doubt, whether or not I should hate her or love her. I asked myself whether there was any reason to torment myself in this way. How many times had I not felt the sting of jealousy only to see it end in nothing at all? It is the same now, surely, maybe. I shall come home to find her sleeping peacefully. She will awaken and be glad to see me. And in the words and looks I shall see that nothing has happened, that all this has been in vain. What if she really hadn't done it, but wished to do it, and I know that she did? That would be even worse. Then it would be better if she'd already done it, to relieve me of my uncertainty. It was a complete madness. We came to the station where I was to disembark. The conductor took the tickets. I took my baggage and went out to the carriage platform, hailed a taxi, got in, and went home. In spite of my efforts, I cannot at this moment remember my state of mind. What did I want? I can't remember. I only know that I was conscious that a serious and menacing event was approaching in my life. I arrived at my steps an hour past midnight. A few carriages were in front of the house, awaiting customers. The cabbies looked up at some lighted windows. The lighted windows were those of our parlour and reception room. Without attempting to account for this late illumination, I went up the steps and rang the bell. The servant, a good, kind-hearted and very stupid being named Igor, opened the door. The first thing that leapt to my eyes was his overcoat. I ought to have been astonished, but I was not astonished. So this was it. I asked Igor whose it was. Tukhachevsky. I scarcely breathed. This was how I had first imagined it, but I thought then that it was all just a product of my imagination. Now, all that I had imagined was true. It was really true. It really existed. I felt so utterly alone. I had to act now, instantly, without hesitation. How? I did not yet know. I only knew that everything was finished, that I immediately wanted to punish her, and that I wanted my relationship with her terminated. Until now, I had at least had doubts. Perhaps this is not true. Perhaps I am mistaken. Now all doubt had disappeared. I feared but one thing, that they might run in different directions, that they might invent some new lie and thus deprive me of material proof and, consequently, my opportunity to punish them. So, in order to take them quickly by surprise, I started to tiptoe, not through the parlour, but through the hall and nursery. In the first room, the boys were asleep, safe and sound. In the second, the old nurse stirred and seemed to be on the verge of waking up, and I wondered what she would think if she found out everything. Self-pity struck me, and I could not keep the tears back. So as not to wake the children, I ran lightly through the hall and into my study. I dropped onto the sofa and sobbed. I, an honest man, I, the son of my parents, I, who all my life have dreamed of family happiness, I, a man who has never betrayed my wife, 5 children. And then I thought, she embraces this musician because he has red lips. And what if I had arrived tomorrow? Then this jealous animal would have remained forever in my heart, tearing at it. What will the old nurse say? And Igor and poor little Lisa? This impudence, this falsehood, this bestial sensuality that I know so well. I took off my boots and advanced towards the wall, over the sofa where firearms and daggers were hanging. I took down a dagger and with a wolf-like tread started for the door. And I opened it. I shall never forget the desperate and sudden fear that appeared in their faces when they saw me. It awakened a feeling of painful joy in me, such as I desired. He, I believe, was at the table, but when he saw or heard me, jumped to his feet and retreated to the sideboard. Fear was the only sentiment that could with certainty be read on his face. On hers, too, fear could be read, but there was also, at least I thought I saw it, a feeling of annoyance at this disruption of her love and happiness. He gave her a questioning glance, and the expression of annoyance on her face changed into an expression of anxiety for him. I stopped, the dagger hidden behind my back. Suddenly he smiled, and in a voice that was indifferent almost to the point of ridicule, he said, "We were just talking about the Kreutzer Sonata. I did not expect you," she added. Then neither he nor she uttered another word. The same rage I had felt the previous week took possession of me. Again, I felt the need for giving free rein to my violent fury and joy of wrath. And so I did. They both froze. What he feared was imminent. I threw myself upon her, still hiding the dagger, so that he might not prevent me from striking where I desired, in her bosom, under the breast. At that moment he saw and threw himself at me. I was not expecting that from him. He seized my arm and cried, "Come to your senses! What are you doing? Help! Help!" I tore my hands from his grasp and pounced on him. Our eyes met, and he turned as white as a sheet. Even his red lips turned white. His eyes sparkled singularly, and he scrambled under the piano. I tried to follow him, but a very heavy weight fell upon my left arm. It was she. I perceived that I was completely mad, and that I must be frightening, and I was glad of it. With all my strength, I dealt her with my left elbow a blow square in the face. She uttered a cry and let go my arm. I wanted to go after him, but it struck me how ridiculous I would look chasing after my wife's lover without my boots on. I seized her. Without losing my dagger, I seized her by the throat with my left hand, forced her to the floor and began to strangle her. With both her hands, she clutched mine, trying to tear them from her throat. I stabbed her in the left side, between the lower ribs, as if it was this I had been waiting for. I felt the resistance of the corset and of something else, and then the sinking of the knife into the soft flesh. She clutched at the dagger with her hands, cutting herself on it, but could not restrain the blow. Toward noon, she died. I was acquitted. The court ruling was as follows: that I was the deceived husband, and that I had killed my wife to defend my injured honour. But I had, in fact, killed my wife long ago, by the life I led. I only began to understand this when I saw her in the coffin. Only then, upon seeing her dead face, did I understand all that I had done. But he who has not lived through it cannot understand it.